Let's dip our toes into the 3D space. What's up? I'm Jonathan and welcome to Maker Tales, where I'm sharing my maker journey to help you go further in yours. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that little bell icon to never miss an opportunity to keep making. This video is all about dipping our toes into the 3D space by grabbing our 2D net that we've created in the last few videos and turning that into a 3D object and understanding everything that is going on. Just before we jump into the 3D space, I just want to show you two more tools. Now, quite frankly, I was going to show you these before, but I thought it might have been a bit overwhelming to show you basically a tool that does the same thing over and over and over again by different means of doing it. So I'm going to recreate the problem that we had here. So I'm going to select these two here, go only faces, go into edge selection, delete these edges right here. And then I'm going to go into our vertex selection and do a quick circle selection of all the vertices right here that we're wanting. Now with that done, I'm going to do our Alt F, X and limited dissolve. So here is our problem. We had to recut this face and that face. So as we already know, that if we had these two vertices selected right here and we were to hit F, well, that doesn't cut the face. So that's why I showed you the knife tool. Really, what I wanted to do was have a simple way of showing you the knife tool. In reality, the best way to do this here is by using another tool, which is the join tool. By just going J, you have now joined these two vertices. And yes, that has cut the face. Now, yes, it can be a little bit weird because you can also join objects. Just be aware that within edit mode and object mode, there are differences. Of course, the join has its limitations. You couldn't go ahead and join this edge to that vertex. So how would we go ahead adding a vertex to this edge? Yes, we could use the knife tool. And right here, if we go K, we could then go to there. We're snapping to it, and we could also hold down control, and that would let us snap to the middle there. But there's another way of doing that as well, which is by going into this edge selection right here. We're going to go right click, subdivide. And this subdivision basically divides up things. It's the first time you've heard subdivide, and there's many times we're going to be using it in the future. But just for now, just know we're doing subdivision in 2D on an edge, and this right here lets us cut our edge up to whatever number we really want. We can go up and up on here if you really wanted. But for now, I'm just going to set it to 1 because that's going to be right in the middle of those two. And now I can select these two vertices right here, hit J, and that is that face cut up and ready to move forward. All right, the time has come. It's time to go from 2D to 3D. So let's start off with our net of the cube that we began creating in our last video. And let's turn this into a 3D object. Now, first of all, we're very much just dipping our toes into 3D mesh building right this minute. By no means is this how it should be done, but I just want to reiterate everything that we've learned in the past few videos. So let's go into our face selection. Let's select our faces. I already have CAD transform switched on here. So I'm going to go ahead and hit R. I'm going to set our axis by going like this. And then I'm going to go and click Y to change our orientation, our axis that we're rotating on. Let's go ahead. Let's type in minus 90. And I'm sure you can already see what I'm doing here. I'm building our cube from the net that we have constructed. So let's go ahead, let's do that. I don't think I need to baby step you through this one because it's pretty obvious where we're going. So just going, creating this and closing it up. Now, once we get to this point, we can go ahead and use our snapping points to just close this. Let's select this one, rotation from here to there. Let's go on the Y, bring it up, snap, and this last face here. Rotation from here to there, Y, and snap it upwards. Now, of course, you probably already know what is wrong with this. If we look at our statistics, there are far too many vertices and edges for what we have going on right here. Now, of course, it might not be that obvious, but a very obvious way would be to select a face, hit G, and try and move it. And you're going to see just how unconnected this is right this minute. So we know the quick fix for this. Let's go into vertex selection. Select everything. Let's hit M for merge by distance, and you can see that has removed 6 vertices, and in all, that is all that it is From here, if we select this face and we do that same move, you can see that it's all joined together. Now, of course, we have this great big gaping hole looking at us saying, hey, you haven't fixed me, so let's sort this out. Right, so first, let me show you just how many ways holes can go wrong in Blender. Let's go into our edge selection. Let's select this edge loop here and select that edge loop there. You might think that it's as simple as hitting F, and I'm sorry to say it isn't. In fact, if you see inside, all that's done is closed up our face. So, how else can we do this? Well, we know there's another fill, which is the Alt-F option. Let's see how that works. So Alt-F, okay, it works, but goodness me, that's given you a whole bunch of edges everywhere. Let's see, let's try our Alt-Limited Dissolve. Okay, it's not perfect though. That's definitely not the way we're wanting to go. Okay, let's undo that, and let's see, is there something else we can do? Well, in reality, there isn't. What we have to do is give Blender a little bit more information. It doesn't know which edge correlates with which is why it triangulates it so much. So let's go ahead, let's hit F to fill this one edge. So it knows, hey, look, those two are definitely connected. So now let's go and do our edge loop select of the entire edge loop, including this new connection point. And you're going to see it might not quite work how you expect. So let's go ahead, let's hit F. Doesn't work. Maybe it's Alt F. Okay, now it's broken. However, there's a secret menu that I have to go and show you, which is Control F. And this is our face menu. And right here under fill, we have grid fill. So let's go ahead, let's click grid fill. And there we have it. Exactly what we're wanting. Now that's a lot of operations for doing that simple job. So let's see if there's a way that we can cut this down. And there is. Instead of having to reselect this entire edge, what we could do is, I'm just going to undo before we added that face, is at this point here, we're just going to go ahead and hit F to fill that one. Then we're going to hit one of these leading edges by selecting it. And then we're going to use the F2 add-on once again. Remember that the F2 add-on is not F2, it's just, it adds extra operations to the fill operation. So that is just by hitting F. And you'll see as I tap it, it fills in the next face over and over. And if I just hold down F, it's going to close up our entire hole here. And that way, we now have exactly what we're looking for. Just before we move on, I think it would be wrong of me to say that using the F2 add-on and grid fill are the only ways to fix this hole. In reality, there is also something that's basically purpose-built for an operation like this. So I'm going to go ahead, delete these faces, I'm then going to select this entire edge loop here, this entire edge loop here, and I'm going to bridge between these two edge loops. And there's another menu here, which is Control E. And as you can imagine, remember, we have Control F for the face menu, Control E is the edge menu. And right here we have bridge edge loops. So let's go ahead, let's click bridge edge loops. And you see we get this. Now there's also some extra little bits that come with this that you can play around with. But as you see, we get the same result. Now, I don't want to get too deep into where to use grid fill and where to use bridge edge loops. I guess the biggest difference that I can show you between the two is if I go ahead and we just select one entire one of these edge loops here. If we go ahead and use the grid fill, and right here we'll go with our Control F, grid fill, we get this result. Okay, if we were to try and do a bridge fill right this minute, bridge edge loops, it will fail because we don't have two separate edge loops. So what would happen if we deselected then one from either side? Well, in reality, that would then work, but it would give us this result here. Now, what would happen if we did a grid fill then with those two like this? Well, believe it or not, it's basically the same result. So things get a little bit more complicated when you start to just select, for instance, one of these and then one over here, and then we go ahead and do a grid fill, we get this strange result. However, a bridge fill would give us something more like this result. So there's a lot to it, and it goes even deeper once we get into different number of vertices between the two joining bridges. So quite frankly, this is one of those that you're going to have to just learn with time. But if you want to know the exact specifics of what makes them different, here's a little link that I found. Here, pause the video to read that. And yeah, that is basically the difference. But the main thing to keep in mind here is you can select things like this, go Control E and go Bridge Edge Loop Fill, and you're going to get basically this same result. And when I say the same results, I say you'll get the same results pretty much 98% of the times, because sometimes if a whole entire edge loop is a little bit rotated just in the wrong way or in the wrong angle, it won't be able to do that bridge loop connection. However, that's why I wanted to show you everything that we've covered so far, because this is the most manual way of joining these edge loops together. So this takes the reliance out of a blender operation and back into your hands in case things don't quite work out how you're expecting. All right, so we've now dipped our toes into the 3D space and created our own cube. So let's go ahead and let's rename this quickly. Let's go into object mode, let's hit F2 for renaming, and let's name this our cube. All right, we have our cube now. Let's reiterate normals now, because it's quite fundamental, especially from where we're going now. So back into edit mode, face selection. I want you to select two faces here, and I want you to just delete the faces. You don't have to do only faces this time. So we'll delete the faces. And you can see we're looking inside of our cube right now. Now, if we set up our cubes correctly, our normals correctly when we first joined all this together, now when we hit Q, our quick menu, and do face orientation. Now, if you haven't got face orientation in there, remember it's over in our overlays. The inside should be red and the outside should be blue. Remember, you can also recalculate those by selecting everything in face select and going shift N to recalculate normals. And right this minute, it's not going to be able to do anything because it thinks that this is all broken out, because it is. Right this minute, it's not a solid object. It's a broken object. So now let's go ahead and let's take a look at normals in another way. This is the most visual way of seeing normals, where you very much have red for the inside, blue for the outside, but if we go ahead and turn off face orientation, you might have noticed in our overlays, down here we have normals. Now, when we click this one right here, you're going to get all these little blue lines. And all these little blue lines are the normal directionality. Now, this is important, especially for where we're about to go in the 3D space, because a lot of the operations that we're going to be looking into use the normal direction as its default method of movement. And not only that, CAD transforms up here has a snapping to face normal option. So we can even use that within our precision modeling. So this here is a visual representation of that direction. Okay, with that now covered, let's go ahead and see if this would trip you up. If we select these two faces here, hit X, and we delete those faces, let's go ahead and let's do an edge selection of this edge loop and that edge loop. How would you join these up now? There is no difference. We've covered this exactly in the 2D space for this reason. Whenever you are encountering something like this, just imagine if it was down on a 2D plane and it's exactly the same. So we already know that this is Alt F, X, and then limited dissolve, and there we have it. That's our quick method without our precision edges. And if we're wanting precision edges, let's go to the other side. Let's go into vertex selection, select two vertices, F for fusing them together, select the other two vertices, F for fusing them together. Now we're gonna use our circle selection, but just be aware now that there's a whole bunch of vertices everywhere, so just be careful not to select the wrong thing. I'm selecting vertices here as I'm finding it easier than selecting edges. Now with one entire face selected, I'm going to go into our edge selection, hit F for that fill, and then I'm going to go Alt double click, and it's going to select the other edge loop of the other face. As you see, it's doing a much better job than when it was in a 2D space, because now we're working in the 3D space, and this is what Blender's expecting. So from here, we can fill that, and now we have our precision edges set in place. So there we go. We have just dipped our toes into the 3D space, and now we understand normals, we understand how to turn 2D into 3D, and now we can really start to explore the power of Blender. Well done! You have just dipped your toes into the 3D space by creating a net of a cube all the way from a single vertex to a three-dimensional object. Of course, it's extremely convoluted the way that we've gone about this, but the main reason why is you now understand the connection point between the 2D space and the 3D space, because quite frankly, that point right there in between the two is usually the root of most problems when it comes to mesh modeling. A huge thank you to my patrons. You guys are absolutely awesome, and it's the reason I'm able to make these videos right here. And if you're enjoying what I'm making here, and you think I'm worthy of your support, I would love to see you there too. Don't forget that we have a Discord, and that's linked down in the description. Thank you for watching. Keep